Thank you, Tuan Haji Sibley. Ladies and gentlemen, Citizens International is a global people's network which advocates people activism on issues of peace, cultural cooperation, sustainable development, and traditional knowledge systems, among others. Citizens is managed by a board of trustees of experienced non-government organization activists led by none other than Mr. S.M. Mohamed Idris, who is also the president of Consumers Association of Penang. Without further ado, I would like to invite Mr. S.M. Mohamed Idris, chairperson of Citizens International, to give his welcoming address.
Ministry of Higher Education, Malaysia, and friends. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. On behalf of Tan Sri, Professor Zulkifli Razak, Vice Chancellor, University Sains, Malaysia, and Citizens International, I welcome you all to Penang and to this very significant and important conference. We have participants from around the world, and many of you, despite your busy schedule, have traveled thousands of miles to be here to participate in the conference. Your presence have highlights the universal concern for decolonizing our universities, which forms the theme of this conference. This conference is an attempt, the long overdue task of freeing our learning institutions from the Eurocentric framework and assumptions that they are modeled upon, and hopefully will pave the way for us to discover our authentic selves and become people who are truly liberated. I'm not a scholar, nor an academic, but an activist who grew up at a time when the victims of colonialism in Asia, Africa, and Latin America were waging valiant struggle for justice, freedom, independence, and liberation. Like many anti-imperialists among my generation, the seeds of resistance to imperialism were sown at a very young age. Let me share with you a personal experience which is still fresh in my memory. As a young boy at the Anglo-Chinese school in Penang, a Methodist missionary school, I defied the principal, Miss Morton, and refused to wear shorts to school. I was not going to allow any such alien imposition on me. I carried on wearing long trousers to comply with the Muslim class code, dress code. Much to the annoyance of Miss Morton, the spirit of resistance still continues in me and those anti-imperialists of my generations who are still alive. When the Union Jack was lowered, we cheered, believing that we had freed ourselves from the centuries-old shackles of colonialism, to stand tall among other nations, proud of our language, culture, tradition, and knowledge system. That our belief was naive and misplaced was impressed upon me by an incident in 1987 during my visit to Kolkata with Claude Alvarez and other colleagues from Third World Network. We went to a restaurant for a meal, but I was denied entry only because I was wearing a sarong. I don't know, some of you may not know what sarong is. Sarong is called in Malay, it is called lungi in Hindi and so on. It's a dress I'm wearing just now. To my dismay, I realized Miss Morton was still around, even in the land of Mahatma Gandhi. We failed to understand that colonialism has struck deep roots in our societies. Not only did it control our politics and economy, but more serious and damaging to the colonized. It was an insidious force that permeated all aspects of our lives to take total control of us. My friends, if you look at us who are here today, people who are keenly aware of this malady that afflicts us. But whatever said and done, how many of us would, as a norm, dress in our own attire? We'd be too embarrassed to do so. We fear that it would not be acceptable and that we would be looked down upon. This is a milder degree of the affliction. In more serious cases, there are those of us who resort to skin whiteness and surgery of double eyelids and to bleach our hair blonde in the pursuit of transmuting ourselves from Asian to becoming Fox Caucasians. The colonialists, overcome by their rapacity, abandoned any sense of morality in their colonial exploits around the world. They built a web of lies that the colonized were infantile, uncultured, and grotesque beings who needed to be cultivated and saved. In the worst cases, the indigenous people, they even denied them the humanity and committed genocide against them. Lord Macaulay, who designed the Indian educational system, arrogantly declared that all the historical information which has been collected from all the books written in the Sanskrit language is less valuable than what may be found in the most paltry abridgments used in the preparatory schools in England. This is a blatant lie, as Europe borrowed heavily without acknowledging from the vast storehouse of knowledge of the Arabs, Indians, Chinese, Africans, and Amerindians. The colonial education system was a vehicle for propagating these lies. It was meant to produce an army of administrators, clerks, professionals, and intellectual elite would uphold and defend. Colonial system. Their education cut them off from their historical, cultural roots and connect them to the worldview, values and norms of the West, which were internalized in them. The result of this radical social engineering was that it produced a local elite with colonized mind, crippled imagination, and lacking in creativity and originality. It made a caricature of them, undermining their confidence, self-esteem and dignity. Their lifestyle and tastes and values were far removed from those of the ordinary masses and closer to their colonial masters. They were Macaulay, the way Macaulay would have put it, a class of persons, Indians, Malays, Chinese, Africans, in blood and color, but in English, in tastes, in opinions, in morals, and in intellect. When the colonialists folded their flag and left, power passed into the hands of these members of this class. They took charge of the institutions, the civil service, judiciary, police, universities, etc., created by colonialism to serve its interest and continue to operate them without dismantling their philosophical and ideological underpinnings. Our universities are the purveyors of the imperialist worldview and ideology. They play the role of perpetuating Western hegemony through the education models that is so destructive to our culture, language, way of life, knowledge system, and dignity. To achieve true liberation and recover our authentic selves, we need to purge the West within us. As C. Alvarez et al. Write in their blinded eye, 500 years of Christopher Columbus, the Columbus within may be even great obstruction than the Columbus without. His science, his economics, his attitudes toward nature, his perceptions of gender and health, his outlook, the other and their languages have struck deep roots within us. Pulling out these institutions by the roots may cause great pain, but there is no compelling reason why this fundamental task must remain undone. Towards the task of purging the Columbus within, Citizens International and the other India press launched the Multiversity project. We have had three international conferences on the subject of continuing Eurocentric dominance of the teaching and research of our universities. We have discussed redesigning of curriculum and issues of hegemony in spirit and in practice. We do not want to be part of an intellectual world in which we have only the role peddler and parrots. At this conference, which is the first on decolonizing universities, on making coursework independent of European influence, either in theory or method, we thought we would signal the decolonization process by asking brilliant academics to share their views of non-Eurocentric courses. How would these courses look like? Would they be credible? Would they indeed be able to form the scaffolding of an independent social science perspectives, not governed by any longer from the European conceptions? Can we go further? Appropriate the freedom to include or reject these social sciences useless for us or incompatible with our religious compulsions and create our own new ones.